Well, on this question of reading the Bible together as Jews and Christians, I have to begin by saying I haven't got a lot of experience of it in practice. I've been a member of several Jewish Christian discussion groups, and in some of them we have engaged in some Bible study, though normally we talked about other matters on the whole. But I haven't got all that much experience. And I thought the most useful thing I could do in this short talk was to look at a few issues of principle that are involved in joint study of scripture. And I'm sure you all have more practical experience of doing it than I have. So I look forward to the discussion later. And these are some, I'm afraid, rather random thoughts on the subject, but there we are. Christians often approach study of the Hebrew Bible with an assumption that it runs into the New Testament and is completed by it. They don't see a divide between the two testaments, in a sense. And that's part of the Christian tendency to read what we still call in Christian circles the Old Testament as messianic in orientation, pointing forwards to the Messiah whom Christians identify as Jesus. Now, obviously, this is deeply problematic in the context of Jewish Christian discussions. It needs to be on the table, I think, but this is the default reading for many Christians, and one has to acknowledge that for many Christians, especially those who haven't engaged in any dialogue with Jews, it is just an assumption that the Old Testament is all about pointing forward to the Messiah. Of course, anyone who studies the Hebrew Bible knows how comparatively marginal messianic prophecy really is in it. It's there, but it's an idea that developed much more post-biblically in the later Second Temple period, rather than very much within the Hebrew Bible itself. And of course, the identification of this Messiah with Jesus of Nazareth is very, very far from obvious. Christians who are better informed know this and don't try to convince Jews that Jesus is the promised Messiah. But my point is not really about messianic prophecy as such, but about the underlying understanding of the nature of the Bible that goes with an interest in it, and which often persists, even for those of us who have largely abandoned arguing about the Messiah. And this understanding is that the Bible tells a story which runs smoothly from the Old into the New Testament, from the Hebrew Bible into the New Testament, and that it's a story about the whole human race and God's long-term purposes for humanity as a whole. And that's how Christians tend to see the Bible. Now, obviously, this is a problem for Jewish readers who don't see the New Testament as any kind of continuation of the Hebrew Bible. It's symbolized in many ways by the way our respective Bibles are arranged. Typically, Christian Bibles arrange the part we call the Old Testament so that the last books in it are the prophets, which are seen as leading the story of world history through into the revelation of God's purposes in Jesus. Christians often treat the Christian Bible as telling a story that runs from the creation of the world in Genesis 1 to the end of all things in the book of Revelation. Now, this, quite apart from the issue of messianism, implies a quite different understanding of scripture, I think, from any viable Jewish understanding of it. That's my, how far as I've managed to grasp the difference anyway. Think of the Jewish Bible organized into Torah, prophets, and writings with a kind of descending order among those parts. The prophets there are commentary and explanation of the Torah rather than being there primarily because they look forward to some kind of messianic future. That theme is there, but it's not central to the way Judaism understands the prophets in my, as far as I've grasped it. And people sometimes say that Jews and Christians may differ over the question whether the New Testament is scripture, but at least they agree on sharing the Hebrew Bible. And it seems to me that the characteristic ways they read the Bible means that this is only partially true. We do share these books in a sense, but the two communities make quite different interpretations of them and arrange them in different ways, and the arrangement symbolizes the difference in understanding. So when Christians and Jews together study a piece of the Hebrew Bible, it's a shared text only to a certain extent. because it's embedded in assumptions that are not shared by all. And this comes out usually in such dialogue, if the dialogue is honest. And it's very helpful that it does, because I don't believe the point of shared reading of the Bible is to reach some kind of agreement, much more to understand each other's points of view, to see where we're respectively coming from. Sometimes agreement can emerge. More often what emerges is fruitful disagreement that can lead to a real appreciation of the other's position. The idea that the Bible tells a great overarching story, and that individual passages we may study fit into that story, can be an attractive way of framing the discussion. But my fear is that in the end, it's unconsciously slanted towards a Christian way of understanding the Bible and may not resonate with Jewish readers. Of course, everyone can see that the Bible does contain many stories, but the idea of a big master narrative, as it's sometimes called today, reaching from one end of history to the other, has traditionally been a rather distinctively Christian way of thinking about scripture. It's noticeable in the world of academic biblical study that it's mostly been Christian scholars who've written books called The Theology of the Old Testament, unifying all the books around some central theme. Though there is now a burgeoning literature of Jewish biblical theology, which I'll come back to. But Jewish writers have tended more often to concentrate on particular books or themes. And of course, they've stressed the primacy of the Torah over the rest of the Bible, which is an approach many Christians fail to understand. Because for Christians, all the books of the Hebrew Bible are, as it were, on a level. They're all equally important, or for some Christians, equally unimportant. The last book of the Hebrew Bible, of course, is not a prophecy at all, as it is for Christians, who generally put Malachi last, but Chronicles, which ends with the permission given to the exiled Jews to return to the land. And the final word of the Bible on this understanding is the verb v'ya'al, let him go up, which is what the Emperor Cyrus says to those Jews who want to return to the land. And the Hebrew Bible is much more about living a faithful life under God, much less about looking for a messianic future than most Christians realize. Moshe Goshen Gottstein, a great Jewish biblical scholar, sums it up like this. He says, for Christians, the Bible is about God, humanity, and salvation. But for Jews, it is about God, the people, and the land. And I think it's important to know that contrast if one isn't to blunder around trying to find false points of contact. Nevertheless, joint study of the Bible can be very fruitful indeed for encouraging mutual understanding. And I feel that such joint study as I've done has made me more aware of where the heart of Judaism really beats, instead of treating it as a kind of Christianity without Jesus, as Christians often falsely do. And I'm not claiming that I have wonderful insight into Judaism as an outsider, I don't. But joint study I've done has made me more aware that Jews prioritize different themes in the Bible than those that Christians tend to prioritize. I mentioned that some Jewish writers are now taking an interest in biblical theology, and this represents a movement to engage with Christian biblical scholarship where this kind of thing has been more at home. But what these Jewish writers are stressing is not the unity of the Bible, the overarching story way of looking at it, but the enormous variety to be found in scripture. And this is something Christians tend not to realize, or perhaps to shy away from, because they generally have a tendency to want to unify and systematize the contents of the Bible. I think especially of Ben Sommer, an American Jewish scholar who's written extensively on biblical theology. And he reminds us of the principle, davar acher, another opinion or another point, which is so common in rabbinic literature. The text could mean this, but then again, it could mean that. And some people say one thing and some another. And that's not regarded as a kind of disaster or a mistake. It's regarded as rather creative. Christians tend to want to ask what the text really means. What is its one true meaning? But Sommer argues that Jewish reading is always open to a variety of ways of understanding the text. It isn't part of a grand narrative. It's made up of many atoms of meaning most of which should be read as bearing on how to live well, rather than on prophecy or on a big story. Christians reading with Jews need to be aware of this principle and to be receptive to many ways of understanding any given passage from the Bible. Christians can find that infuriating, but if they stay with it, they come to see the wisdom of it. My own feeling is that this would actually help Christians to read the New Testament better too, rather than looking for the one true meaning all the time. The great New Testament scholar Ernst Käsermann made the point that the New Testament does not bear witness to the unity of the early Christian church, but to its diversity. And the diversity of Christianity is one of the truths that Christians should be clear about in dialogue with Jews, not pretending that we are somehow monolithic and all believe the same things, as we don't. Variety is one of the features Jews and Christians share, not something that distinguishes between them. And variety certainly characterizes the way both faiths read their scriptures. The difference is that Christians sometimes feel bad about this, whereas I believe we could benefit from an appreciation of the principle of davar acher. As a biblical specialist, I find myself in the position of not being wholly comfortable with traditional Christian ways of reading scripture anyway. I suppose I'm very much on the liberal wing of Christianity, and I can't accept some traditional Christian formulations, such as a strong belief in messianic prophecy. But rather than wanting to set up an alternative way of reading the scriptures, I would want above all to stress the benefit of variety within the Bible. Of course, there are givens. They're givens on which Jews and Christians agree, such as the existence of one God who cares for humankind. But there is also a bewildering variety of teachings which can't all be neatly reconciled with one another. And that's true whether one looks at the Hebrew Bible or the New Testament. In joint study, Christians can benefit from a Jewish eye being cast over the New Testament. And there are recent books on this subject, such as the very recently published book, The Bible With and Without Jesus, by Amy Jill Levine and Mark Brettler, which I think is an excellent study of how the Bible looks, how the New Testament looks from different perspectives. And many of Amy Jill Levine's other publications do indeed cast a Jewish eye on the New Testament to everyone's benefit. Sometimes it's helpful not just to study the allegedly shared scriptures, that is the Hebrew Bible, but passages from the New Testament on the one hand, or from the Talmud or Midrash on the other, to see how they look when seen through other eyes. Seems to me nothing but good can come of joint study at local level. Religious leaders sometimes feel they have to toe a party line in many contexts, but local groups of Jews and Christians can come to understand each other and perhaps to disagree fruitfully without being constrained by rules. It's a great thing to trust each other so much that you can disagree without damage to the relationship, and that's rendered easier if we come to appreciate how much disagreement there is even within the Bible itself, not to mention within both Jewish and Christian traditions. Being aware that there can usually be another opinion without wanting to reconcile all differences has been important in both faiths, in fact, though Christians all too often have a desire to enforce a single interpretation with bad consequences, both for Christians and non-Christians from ancient times right up to the present day. One might think of the recent death of Hans Küng, the Swiss Catholic theologian, who was forbidden for many years from teaching Catholics because he often espoused another opinion from the church hierarchy. Hearing other opinions, however, is good for the heart and soul, and I think Jewish Christian groups can practice this in a very special way. Thanks very much.